It's Tuesday night, so you know what that means. Bobcat Breakdown is back. Who is the Quinnipiac Women's Basketball midseason MVP? How can Quinnipiac Women's Hockey keep its hot streak? And what is wrong with the Quinnipiac Men's Basketball team? Find out all this and more right now. Roll the intro. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Bobcat Breakdown. I'm your host, Liz Flynn, and tonight I'm joined with Steve Pappas and John Surratt. Boys, you ready to have some fun?
I'm ready, Steve. How are you?
You're ready with that suit. I mean, it's popping right now with that blue.
You got the gold, you got the riches maybe tonight.
I'm all for it. Let's get into it.
Hey, you both look great. Maybe it'll bring you some good luck. Let's kick things off with some Quinnipiac men's ice hockey. The team had a very busy weekend defeating...
Wishing that either A, they win the ECAC Hockey Conference and they don't need an at-large bid, or B, that everything goes in their favor, because they need a lot of help if they want to get in with where they're at right now. The fact that this also would have given them some leeway come this weekend against Clarkson. Now it feels like Clarkson is a must-win. If you were able to get a win out there against Brown and Providence, it kind of... It lessens the importance of this game. You still would like to win on Friday, but it wouldn't be a necessity. Now it's a necessity. And with, like I said, the at-large bid, it makes it so much bigger. Also, that this is all without saying that the Bobcats can't win the ECAC Hockey Conference. That very well could happen. And this might not even matter. The pairwise might not even matter at this point as long as they win the ECAC Hockey Conference.
I mean, you know, they showed out against Cornell, Clarkson again. They're coming out. So I wanted to kind of take it looking at a bigger deal mentally. You know, this season, they went into the Brown game down 2-0. They went back and tied the game. It shows that the team is inconsistent. You know, coming back from the weekend prior, beating Cornell, beating Colgate, and then, but also coming off a tough win against Yale, it's hard to come back after that in overtime 3-2. While the Brown tie, it's really hard to come back. You know, we talk all about inconsistencies, and this team has been very inconsistent from weekend to weekend basis or even period to period. You know, it's wishy-washy for them. They definitely needed that point against Brown or to get up into the pair, move up in pairwise. So, yeah, I definitely agree with this Clarkson game being way more of a bust win.
That being said, making sure they got that point in the Brown game, it got them ahead of Harvard in the standings. But, you know, you can't help but wonder what if they ended up beating Brown and now kind of being in that top 10.
And Brown's been giving them struggles this season and then also last season in ECAC hockey tournament, beat them, you know, without Chase Prisky, but still giving them the troubles that they always, you know, it's always going to be a tough game against Brown for Quinnipiac.
Absolutely.
Okay, guys, let's jump ahead a little bit. The Bobcats are home this weekend, meeting with the 5th-ranked Clarkson Golden Knights on Friday. Clarkson is 9-2-2 on the road, while Quinnipiac is 10-2 at home. John, do you think home ice advantage is at play here for the Bobcats?
I think it is a big deal, but I just don't think it's that big of a deal. Last season, Quinnipiac lost to Clarkson at Frank Perotti Jr., but at Clarkson, they ended up winning. So, you know... history can kind of repeat itself most possibly this year. Quinnipiac coming off like an inconsistent weekend. We'll see. But the fans do definitely get hyped up for these big games. We saw against Cornell. The home atmosphere, the home ice definitely brings a big advantage. But their inconsistencies right now is really not – it's not going to make it as big of a deal, I think, for being on home ice.
You heard what Liz said, correct? 10-2. 10-2 on home ice. And that's huge for a young team. At home, the friendly confines of the Frank Parati Jr. Arena. The last 2 years, it's taken down number one teams in the country. They've shut out number one teams in the country at the Frank Parati Jr. Arena. For a team to be at home with such a young team, it's huge. There's well-documented road struggles for this team. They're not a very good road team. Being that this game's at home, they're 7-0 against the conference at home. Uh-huh. This is huge that it's at home. The fans are loud. The fans get after it. They make this place a hard place to play in the conference. And when they're out in droves like they were against Cornell, like I would assume they will be on Friday, it's a very tough place to play. They make the fans, the atmosphere, it makes players make uncharacteristic mistakes.
We talked about the inconsistencies, but Clarkson coming in is 9-2-2 on the road. So that's just another reason why I think home ice, Clarkson's a good road team. It's going to be, you know, a big contest. ECAC hockey always going to be big, but they're definitely trying to show out and be and show why right now, currently record-wise, they're still the best team in ECAC hockey.
I will say this. 5-3-1 of the Bobcats against ranked teams at the Frank Parati Jr. Arena over the last two seasons. That's not, it's not a staggering number, but they have a winning record at home, and it shows why. However, this team, this Clarkson team, really kind of is similar to that Cornell team that we saw a couple weeks ago. They're a big physical team. They play defense really well. They have a rock in goal. It just comes down to what is going to be the atmosphere here at the Frank Parati Jr. Arena. Can the fans make Clarkson get out of their game? And it's something that, you know, we've seen time and time again with UMass last year and with Cornell this year.
I mean, definitely. I just don't think it's going to be as big as we just talked about. But I still think they're going to get the win at the end of the day. But it will. The home atmosphere will add something, just not as much as, you know, against Cornell or something.
Yeah,
like
this has been kind of a low-key rivalry. We haven't really talked about it as much.
Definitely.
All right, guys. We're going to have to wait until Friday to find out. From one locker room to the next, let's talk about the Quinnipiac women's ice hockey team. The Bobcats had a very successful weekend sweeping Union and RPI, and they are currently on a four-game winning streak. Women's ice hockey beat reporter Connor Ullathorne has more on those games and some standout players. Connor?
After a sweep against Union and RPI, the Quinnipiac women's ice hockey team has found a new player on their first line, Taylor Gerard. Let's hear what Cass Turner and others had to say about the first year's performance.
Taylor is playing great hockey, but I think you hit it. It's all in what she's doing to turn pucks over. She has a great stick, and she's working hard. She's blocking shots. She's committed to doing everything she can to make the right play in the right moment.
She's great. She brings so much. She works so hard, and I think that's something we need in our forecheck, and she sets an example for all the forwards, so to have her back in the lineup has definitely been awesome.
They just work hard, like D-zone, offensive zone, like we just find each other, like things just connect.
And while the forecheck was another big factor on the ice for the Bobcats, there was one player that stood out in particular, Laura Lundblad with their first career hat trick.
A breakaway goal and two more against RPI gave the junior her first ever hat trick, and even she was surprised about the third goal going in.
Honestly, it was so exciting. I was just kind of amazed that it happened, you know, 10 seconds left in the game, and puck just sent it up on my stick in front of an open net. It doesn't get better than that, so, yeah.
Now you've heard it from me, you've heard it from the players and the coach. Now let's hear what our two analysts have to say about these two players at the desk.
Well, Steve, I definitely think over the past four games, the past 2 weeks, I do think the player has been Taylor Gerard. She had over the past four games two goals and four assists, so making an impact in all four games and coming in only two goals and five assists total over 13 games. So she definitely improved her play. She's had adding that playmaking that the team needed. They needed those goals. Again, they weren't playing the best of teams, but they still got four straight wins, and now 10 in pairwise ranking, or USCHO, excuse me. So they're showing out, and I think Taylor Gerard, just her playmaking, her scoring, overall for the whole.
All right, I'm going to go with a recency bias pick, and it's hard to not pick a player that didn't just win the ECAC Hockey Player of the Week in Laura Lundblad. I mean, you have a player right here that was the best in her conference, put up 5 points this weekend, and I know it's over the last four games. They both have 6 points over the last four games. However, Laura Lundblad over last weekend had 3 goals on Saturday to follow up, with a 2-assist night on Saturday. Granted, the 1-assist performance last weekend kind of stifles the numbers a little bit, being that it's just the one weekend sample, but I mean, if you give me somebody that won the best player in the conference award for a weekend, I will go, and has the same amount of points as Taylor Girard, I will go with a player that has the hardware to back it up.
What I wanted to say is, you were at the RPI game.
Yes.
When she got her hat trick. It was 3-1, right? She had a goal already, and she got the last two goals. How important of were those goals? She wasn't like, it was really last second. I know hat trick's big, but it's just how impactful was that hat trick? How much did that really matter to the outcome of the game?
The question here is not how impactful were the players. It was who was the best. And if you have a hat trick in one game and two assists in the next game, I mean, you can't not.
Was she really the best? It's over four games.
Yes.
We talked about that. And the weekend she had prior just doesn't live up to what Girard did over the weekend prior to this RPI and Union weekend. Lundblad had an amazing weekend. If this was just the past two games, I would agree with you with Lundblad. But the two games prior, it really just makes the bigger impact there. So
I will give you this. Taylor Girard was more consistent over the four games. Laura Lundblad, the biggest star over those four games.
Well, we'll see how her impact comes in. Both players impacting as Clarkson is.
Well, guys, you both make some very good points. The team is taking on Clarkson this Friday, and that is QBSN's Game of the Week. So let's hear some important factors to consider and maybe some predictions. Steve?
Yeah, this is a team that Clarkson, Quinnipiac's now ranked. For the first time since 2017, September of 2017, this Quinnipiac Bobcats team is ranked. And even when they were unranked, they played this Clarkson team really well. There were times where there were ties where it looked like Clarkson was the best team in the country, Quinnipiac would tie them. Now it seems like the tide is shifting a little bit. It was tough earlier in the season against Clarkson for this women's team, but now going out to Clarkson with the momentum that they've gained from this recent bump into the top 10. Granted, the funny thing about that is there's 11 teams now ranked in the top 10 for the women's polls. There's two teams tied at 10. But I think with the wins over Harvard, number 9 in the country at the time, the win over Minnesota Duluth, the number 10 team in the country, there's a chance for this team to really ride this momentum. And four-game winning streak that they're on right now, I wouldn't be surprised to see them go in to Clarkson and get a big win. We talked about the men's with the Paralyzed. The women, only 8 teams make the tournament for the women's side. Women ranked right now 11th in the Paralyzed, right behind conference rival Harvard. You mean to tell me that a big win this weekend against Clarkson to knock them possibly into that top 8 is not at the front of their mind? That's pretty good ammunition.
It definitely is, but Steve, how many losses has Clarkson had at home?
Not many.
They have 0. 14-0-2. Oh, at home this season, and we all know what happened last year in ECAC hockey. Quinnipiac versus Clarkson. Clarkson was down 1 goal. They had the series lead at the time, down 1 goal. A few seconds left, they tie it, win in overtime.
Yeah, that's a tough loss. That was
a tough one. I'm honestly going to think that it's going to happen. Something similar is going to happen like that. I really want to go specific here. Really, it's going to be tied going into the third period, and what one of any Clarkson stars is really going to get the last goal of the game to seal it. But it's really going to show to the whole country, to everyone, that, you know, Quinnipiac's always competed with teams, Princeton, Ohio State, that are up there in rankings. And this game, they're really going to show again why they're a force to be reckoned with. And, you know, I really do think it's going to be one of those heartbreaking losses again, but it's going to bump them down a little bit. But I just can't see them getting the first win to Clarkson at their home ice.
There is a different swagger to this team this season that we have not seen in years past.
I agree.
And, you know, as soon as you get ranked, you get that extra jolt of confidence. Now you're going into a top 10's den to try and take them down, to try and be one of those top 8 teams in the country to try and get a spot if they don't win the ECAC Hockey Conference. That's some pretty good ammunition to pull off an upset.
I agree. Their confidence is definitely up there over the, you know, winning 4 in a row, but we'll see. I think it'll be close, but definitely.
Great stuff, guys. I'm going to give you some time to breathe now. We are going to take a short break, but when we come back, the boys debate some basketball, and then we give you our final roars. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back. Let's talk some hoops. Boys, there is no doubt that the men's basketball team has been struggling. One player in particular that hasn't really been himself lately is Rich Kelly. Kelly normally averages 16.2 points per game. However, the past two games, he has only racked up 15 points total. The question is simple. Can this team still compete if Kelly isn't on? John?
No. It's so simple. He's what runs this team. I was looking at some advanced stats, but currently the best guard in offensive rating, he has the highest usage rate of players who actually do play, and the best defensive rating behind Aaron Falzone. He's what runs this whole team. He's the shooter, he's the playmaker, he can defend, he's the leader, and if he's not on, Tyrese Williams had a few games here and there, but the past eight games, they're 2-6, and he hasn't been well, and so the whole team's not been shooting well. And so just that leadership, that mentality, he's been there for 3 years now with head coach Baker Dunleavy. They definitely need him to start stepping it up. 0 points in the first half against Iona. You can't do that if you're the leader. Possible MAC player, I don't think so anymore. I thought earlier when they were 4-0 in the MAC.
Answer me this. First of all, I'll give you a quote. The late, great Yogi Berra. Okay. Deja vu all over again. Did we not have this conversation last season with Cam Young? That can this team survive without one player? Maybe. I'm going to say possibly because of the play of Tyrese Williams. I think Tyrese Williams is a fantastic basketball player. Can he carry this team, though, if Rich Kelly is not at the top of his game? I don't think so. If you look down some of these stats, some of the guys on this team that are having off years, you look at Jacob Ragone. Right now, scoring-wise, he's having possibly his worst season so far at Quinnipiac. When your center, talking about Kevin Marfo, is outscoring your sharpshooter, I think you have a serious issue with how things are run. And for Jacob Ragone to be where he's at right now, if the Bobcats want to succeed, they need him to get back to where he is, because guys like Rich Kelly, guys like Tyrese Williams, and guys like Kevin Marfo, they've been doing their job this season. I think Jacob Ragone has really kind of been dragging behind the rest of them, to say the least.
I will say he's definitely not been the best, but He's not going to take over the game. He's a sharpshooter. He's a spot up 3-point shooter.
He's a sharpshooter averaging less than the center. Let's put it that way.
But they do so many. Their whole offense is oriented around the pick and roll game. Their centers are going to get points. They're going to get playmaking points. Ragone is just not making his shots. Of course, like he's going to shoot. Head coach Baker Dunleavy says they're shooters. They're going to make their shots at one point. So. You know, I do think Kelly at the end is the main reason right now they've been struggling. His points per game have also dropped. They definitely need him to start coming back. He's the leader. He's the engine. I know Ragone has been struggling, but it's just hard for a sharpshooter when, you know, he's also third year. It's hard for a sharpshooter to be the main reason why this team's struggling. I think Kelly, your leader, has to be the main reason.
Yeah, I think as student media as a whole, we're getting pretty good at answering these questions, because it seems like every year we have these questions that are going to be posed with Cam Young last year, Rich Kelly this year. I think it's very shaky if Rich Kelly's not at the top of his game, but I think for what we answered the question last year with Cam Young was a bigger part of the team than Rich Kelly was.
I think this team though is definitely way more team oriented. They're a different team. Kelly is the main scorer, but they got Aaron Falzone now from Northwestern, Ragone Williams, Pickron now back, McGuire's had on and off. They're definitely a different team. They're definitely younger, though. They're definitely trying to learn the ropes, starting out 4-0, but we'll see.
It's the ebbs and flows of a season, and at 6-6 where they stand right now, it's just a chance to kind of get back into the MAC as long as guys get back to where they should be.
Mm-hmm.
Well, as if the individual struggles weren't enough, let's look at the streaks. The Bobcats started out in MAC play 4-0, and now they've lost 6 out of their last 8. Steve, what do you think is going wrong?
You got to look at the turnovers. I mean, 25 turnovers strictly on Sunday. That doesn't get... simple math will tell you, the more possessions...
18 in the first half.
Yeah, 18 in the first half. The simple math will tell you, the more possessions you give the other team, it's the less that you have to score. It's the more points you're going to give up. And you go back to Manhattan, I'm sorry, they had 20 against Manhattan and 25 against Niagara 2 weeks ago. I mean, these are numbers that you cannot succeed with. And for a team that struggles with scoring, you can't be giving teams extra possessions to take advantage of your lack of scoring.
I mean, turnovers have been a big issue. I will say that, but I think everything has been a big issue. They're shooting, when they started out 4-0, they were beating teams by 12 points, won 3 out of 4, or excuse me, turned the ball over 3 out of 4 times less than their per season average, which you just talked about, but we're also out-rebounding teams by 14.5. That's insane. Over these past 8 games, they're only out-rebounding teams by 0.75. They have gotten out-rebounded by 5 out of 8 times over, and a big outlier is the Canisius game. They saw it 61%. So it's really everything. They haven't been doing much things well. When they beat Ryder and Monmouth, two of the top teams in the MAC right now, they look like world beaters. And now it's really just like they're not rebounding, they're not hustling, they're not showing off why this team has that leadership, that capability. Tyrese Williams said in the interview, they know what they can do. They'd blow out every single team if they just did everything right. So
yeah, we talked about inconsistency with men's ice hockey.
They're way more inconsistent.
Very inconsistent teams at the bank this season.
All right, we're going to stay on the hardwood, but let's now talk about women's basketball. It's said time and time again, the team's different. The winning streak is broken, and you don't really know what you're going to get each game. You could say that the regular season has definitely been shaky, so what does that say for the future? Steve, is this team built for the playoffs, and can they make a run like they've done year after year?
Listen, they're built for the playoffs, and I will trust the team.
Good thing.
However, make a run to the finals like they've had over these past couple of years and the dominance that they've had over the past couple of years, they don't have it. They don't have the scores. They don't have the consistency. They don't have the deep bench to be able to go through that they've had over the past couple seasons to really succeed in the MAC tournament. I do think it's time that this team kind of passes the torch to a Maris or to a Ryder.
Steve, what other team has 5 to 6 players who have MAC title experience, who a coach who's won it so many times, Trisha Fabry? The team, you said it, they're built. They have the experience, though, that more than any other team. You know, the team, they've definitely been catching fire of late, too. They're showing off why, you know, they had a big lineup change with Mackenzie DeWeese and Shaq Edwards in the backcourt and Curtier Haywood in the front court now, first year, coming in. The whole team around has been becoming better shooters, playmaking-wise. They have the more experience. I can't say, until you beat the best, you aren't the best.
Okay, boys, we are going to take one more break, but when we come back, John, Steve, and I hit you with our final roars. Stay tuned. Thank you. back to Bobcat Breakdown. We are coming to the end of tonight's show, so it's time for final roars. John, start us off.
Back in 1998, Quinnipiac had just became a Division I program. Now, over that time, many teams have had a ton of success. Of course, we can start with men's ice hockey. You have competed in the national championship and make the NCAA tournament all time. Quinnipiac women's basketball has won the MAC multiple times and has won the NCAA tournament games. Women's tennis rarely loses MAC matches. Rugby has won 3 national championships. Men's lacrosse has won the MAC and has won an NCAA tournament game. Baseball just won the MAC and win an upset ECU. Women's ice hockey has made the NCAA tournament and always competes in ECAC hockey. Akron competes for one of the best programs in the country, and men's basketball, women's lacrosse, volleyball, and many more are all budding to have more success. Now, what's the point? With all this success, it shows that a school in Hamden, Connecticut has grown into one of the better athletic programs in the country. And the rise should be recognized across the country. Bigger programs should start to fear whenever they see Quinnipiac on their schedule every year, as every year the teams are getting better and better with more prospects. No longer should the school be recognized for only their polls, but because of their athletics. Watch out for the future of the Bobcats.
7 years ago, if you asked anyone around the NHL where Quinnipiac was on a map, they'd probably point to somewhere in Western Alberta. But guys like Bryce Van Barbert and Matthew Pekka have paved the way for a small school in Connecticut to be heard by the league. However, none of those guys have really had consistent mainstays in the NHL. There is, however, a former Bobcat that has put Quinnipiac on the map and given a path for guys like Chase Prisky and Brogan Rafferty to be seen by the NHL. Devon Toews of the New York Islanders became the first former Bobcat to play 100 games in the NHL last week and has been a key part in the Islanders' success this season. The defenseman is part of a team that is tied for 5th in the NHL in goals allowed per game, and Toews is the first former Bobcat to really be a standout and integral piece to his team's success. This pains me to say as a New York Ranger fan, but I can't help but enjoy seeing Devon Toews make a name for himself in the NHL and carry that Quinnipiac name with him. Whether he's tearing up the Rangers in an Islander uniform or coming to Broadway to play for the Rangers, Toews will always be a Bobcat in so many eyes around this campus.
For the past couple months, we have been all in on winter sports. Weekends and even some weekdays here and there are spent up at the People's United Center watching students, faculty, and staff fill up the seats for the basketball and ice hockey programs. The phrase "pack the bank" resonates with many students when a huge game's coming up. It's only the second week of February, so you may think that's all there is. But let's see what the future has in store for the spring. The Quinnipiac tennis programs have already started its spring seasons. The men's lacrosse team is 2 games in after coming off a MAC title game appearance last year, while the women's team gets ready to start up tomorrow. Softball begins its season in California at the end of the month, and baseball will be back before you know it after coming off a MAC championship and a win in the NCAA tournament. Sure, it's only February and winter sports playoffs haven't even happened. Yet, let's not forget about the teams we're getting now and we'll get to enjoy long after winter sports are over. So get out and pack the lacrosse stadium, pack the baseball and softball fields, and pack the bleachers next to the tennis courts, and get back up to the People's United Center for Acro and Tumbling. Because even though winter sports will slowly start to come to a close, there is a ton more fun to be had in the spring. 30 minutes have come and gone, so that concludes tonight's show. To stay updated on all our content, be sure to check out our website at q30tv.com and theqbsn.com, and follow us on Twitter at q30sports and at qbsn. For the producers, everyone behind the scenes, Steve and John, I'm Liz Flynn. See you next time, Bobcats.